Brethren, ye suffer fools gladly, seeing ye yourselves are bound. For ye suffer if a man bring you into bondage, if a man devour you, if a man take of you, if a man exalt himself, if a man smite you on the face. I speak as concerning reproach, as though we had been beaten. Howbeit, wherein soever any is bold, I speak foolishly, I am bold also. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they of the seed of Abraham? So am I. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. In labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequent, in deaths oft. Of the Jews, 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice was I beaten with rods, once was I stoned, thrice I suffered shipwreck, a night and a day have I been in the deep, in journeyings often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils by mine own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. Besides those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. Who is weak and I am not weak? Who is offended and I bear not? If I must needs glory, I will glory of the things which concern mine infirmities. The God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is blessed forevermore, knoweth that I lie not. Hear unto the epistle.
Withered away,
because it lacked moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. And other fell on good ground, and sprang up, and bare fruit, and hundredfold. And when he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. And his disciples asked him, saying, what might this parable be? And he said, unto you it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to others in parables, that seeing they might not see, and hearing they might not understand. Now the parable is this, the seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside are they that hear. Then cometh the devil, and taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. They on the rock are they which, when they hear, receive the word with joy. And these have no root, which for a while believe, and in time of temptation are they which, when they have heard, go forth, and are choked with cares and riches and pleasures of this life, and bring no fruit to perfection. But that on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart, having heard the word, keep it, and bring forth fruit with patience. The Gospel of the Lord.
The holy sacrifice of the Mass is offered today to the greater glory of Almighty God in thanksgiving for the gift of his Son, praying a special intention for this parish church and its people. We pray for the universal church throughout the world, for our bishops, for the Diocese of New York, for all bishops, priests, and deacons, and for the laity in their vocation. We pray for peace in the world, especially in the Ukraine, for the leaders of the nations and for our own country, for our sister parish of St. Magnus the Martyr in the City of London, for the priests of the Society of the Holy Cross throughout the world, for the Shrine of Our Lady of Walsingham, and for the Guild of All Souls, whose national shrine this church is. We pray for God's blessings this week on Brandon Baer and Pilar Tudor, celebrating their wedding anniversary. We pray for the sick and the suffering, the poor and the oppressed, remembering Gaylord a priest, John, Robert, Margaret, Elena, Gloria, Mark, Alan, David, Jane, Douglas a priest, Wendy, and Lorraine. In our London Diocesan Companion Cycle of Prayer, we pray for the parish of St. George's, Hanworth Park. We pray for God's blessings on any absent members of the congregation and for all those who watch this Mass by extraordinary means from afar. Of your charity, pray for the happy repose of the souls of the faithful departed, remembering those whose anniversaries occur this week, Justine Emerson Iodacy, Catherine Carey, a benefactress, Frederick Henry Wilkie, Philip Posner, and Dora Mercedes Harkins. We pray for the soul of the Sister Mary Jean, formerly known as Sister Mary Cyril of the community of St. Mary, who worked in this parish while stationed at the House of the Redeemer in the 1950s and died last week, and for the soul of Lansing Moore, lately dead. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace.
Amen.
Do sit down. I'm quite sure you have no idea what my first announcement is going to be. That is that the boiler is not working yet again. Though it is only about 10 years old, and though we have had 8 visits since Christmas and spent $6,000, it still did not fire this morning, though it was working fine yesterday. Clearly, they haven't found the answer to this, but I shall be speaking to them in the morning. Fortunately, we don't have too cold a day today, so I hope you're not tremendously uncomfortable. In the meantime, you can imagine you're at Yorkminster or something like that. I'm sorry to say, very, very sorry to say, that the genius director of the Center Art Studio in the Garment District, which are among the foremost art restorers in the city and in the country, who've done a great deal of work here, particularly the Latin American altar. The director and driving force behind the art studio died suddenly on Friday, which is a very sad thing, not only professionally for us, but personally. He leaves behind a widow and a grown son, and was only 59 years old. So we hope you'll pray for him and his family. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, Amen. We are now in the season of pre-Lent, short but significant, as it leads us to Lent, which begins on Ash Wednesday. The origins of Septuagesima as a liturgical season are slightly obscure. This is one of the last seasons to be added to the liturgical calendar. The roots are Roman, and it is not mentioned until the 6th century, during the time of St. Gregory the Great. It is often thought St. Gregory himself wrote the Mass formularies, especially since the content reflects so much of the conflict and suffering during that time. The note of sadness in most of the texts of these three Masses has given rise to the theory that they were composed at a time when Italy, and Rome in particular, were once more exposed to barbarian invasions and threatened with misfortunes similar to those which had overwhelmed them in the previous century. The 6th century, the time of the institution of Septuagesima, we think, was also a period of pillage and havoc and of uncontrolled pestilence, and hence we have a sorrowful echo in the prayers written at this time. Pre-Lent was intended to help people ease into Lent, and liturgically it looks and feels very much like Lent. The Gloria and that A word were no longer allowed. The tone is quite penitential, with the sacred ministers wearing violet vestments and the hangings also in violet. The main difference is that the fasting characteristics of Lent has not yet begun, and the organ can still play freely. Certainly, there are parts of the description of the church in St. Gregory's time which will remind us of our own. In the parable of the sower, which has been the gospel today since St. Gregory's day, nearly 1,500 years, the importance of the parable is underlined by St. Luke by saying how many people were present, and therefore what our Lord has to say is something important. He has reserved for many people to hear at once. You recall this is not an actual occurrence. This is a parable which he himself told. They would all have been familiar with the process of sowing seed in the springtime, and most would have done so, either being farmers themselves, or having assisted others at this busy season, or worked as children during this seed time. Families often helped each other at critical times. Shepherds' children would help farmers at seed time and at harvest. Farmers' children would help vintners harvest their grapes, and so on. The method used is called broadcasting, which in the 20th century became a metaphor used with the wireless and later with the television. A large basket, almost flat, but with a hollow in the middle, is used to sow the seeds and is held like a painter's palette. As the sower walks, he casts seed into the furrows. Interestingly, it was their custom to plow after the seeds were cast, not before. So the consequences our Lord narrates occur in the time in between, which of course could be several days, depending on how much land you had. He then goes over the situation, which all would understand. Some falls by the wayside and is trodden underfoot or eaten by birds. I know about that since my three nice new trees in front have had all their colored berries picked from them by the birds. Some falls on rocky soil, and when it springs up, it has no depth of soil and no moisture and withers. Some falls in thorns, which choke the small plants. Others fall on good ground and yield a large and bountiful crop. All this they know. They have seen it all their lives. Then we have the explanation, which comes a bit unusually from his own mouth. The seed is, of course, the word of God, broadcast by him as the divine sower. Those by the wayside are those who hear, but then the devil comes and takes the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. It may seem odd to us that the devil is suddenly in this story, and the comparison of the devil with the bird may seem even more peculiar, but that is because it recalls the book of Job. In that book, it says, Satan sent ravens and birds to devour the seed which was sown in the land. Before they could plow in the seed, the ravens picked it from the surface of the ground. It was one of the great difficulties, one which was widely known to people, as it was often discussed in a way to understand their hard lives, which many led, and they could see their troubles in those of Job. Those who are the rocky soil receive the word with joy. It all sounds wonderful. But then they do nothing much about it. And as soon as it gets difficult, they forget all about the word of God and what their Christian lives should be about. All of us know this phenomenon, though for most of us, it is something we could recognize and stop. The time of year when we concentrate on this kind of exercise has now begun. We examine our lives in pre-Lent and Lent and try to see where we have received the word of God, sowed by the divine sower, and let it languish, or even let it wither. None of us is without hope as long as we live, for we are the children of God by baptism and can call on God's grace, his word, the sacraments, and our own prayer life to regain the closer relationship that we had once or desire to have. There is no one, clergy or laity, who cannot grow in Christ and become a better Christian than before. This is the time of year we do it, traditionally. The traditional methods are fasting, abstinence, almsgiving, and prayer. They are as available to you in difficult times in the 21st century as they were in the 6th. Our lives may be superficially different than those lived by the Christians as the Roman Empire finally disintegrated. All security disappeared, barbarians invaded, and famine and pestilence struck. But are they? A simple look at the news would often suggest that our times bear more than a passing resemblance and offer similar challenges to the Christian who has received the word and has as his vocation doing something about it. Then there are those who are like the thorns. The seed is cast on them, they hear the word, then go about their daily lives as they did before, considering the gift of God's church not a blessing which informs their whole lives, but as an optional extra. The cares of the world oppress them. They worry and can't trust in God's providence. Or the riches and pleasures of this life crowd out any consideration of God and their spiritual lives. It just can't compete with the blandishments and attractions available. And these need not be things that are bad in themselves. They may be things that are perfectly beneficial or even worthwhile in themselves, like the fine arts, the lively arts, history, education, and so on. These things are all lovely examples of the human spirit and tell us and speak to us of God. But they cannot be given the importance of God, or they lead us astray. Maria Callas, the greatest singer ever, a devout Greek Orthodox all her life, was once asked about her belief in God later in life. She responded to Edward Downes, "Well, we use the voice we have. We hear the orchestra and their talent. We are carried up by the music, and we all together make something beautiful with the talents we have been given and the work we put into it. It is of supreme importance. But all this comes as a gift from God, like all beauty. And if we do not comprehend this, we could never truly appreciate or communicate beauty. Is it not so?" So none of these concerns, even those which are good in and of themselves, can be allowed to crowd out and obscure God. They must lead us to Him, and so often they do. But if we are choked with them, we shall bring no fruit to perfection. This season beginning and going through Lent to the way of the cross, then the empty tomb, is to make ourselves more and more like those who are on the good ground, on whom the seed falls in an honest and good heart. We endeavor to hear the word, keep it, and bring forth fruit with patience, not only at Easter, but throughout our lives. Indeed, bringing forth fruit with patience from the seed sown by God might be a description of the Christian vocation. The time of year has now come for us to examine our lives as Christians and fix and improve what could be better.
I believe in one God. do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy way. Draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort. Make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knees. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine measure, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us, have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you.
Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you unto everlasting life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray again.
Oh, hold thou up my goings and my past the point fixed.
Thank you.
always and at all times, and in all places give thanks unto thee. O Lord, Holy Father, almighty everlasting God, who with thine only begotten Son and the Holy Ghost art one God, one Lord, not one only person, but three persons in one substance. For that which we believe of thy glory, O Father, the same we believe of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, without any difference or equality. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we pour and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying,
Ah! All glory be to thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for that thou of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his one oblation of himself once offered, the full sins of the whole world, and did institute that in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we thy humble servants do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee, Lord, unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them, according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us, and we in him. Remember also, O Lord, thy servants and handmaids, who have gone before us sealed with the seal of faith, and who sleep the sleep of peace. To them, O Lord, and to all that rest in Christ, we beseech thee to grant the abode of refreshing, of light, and of peace. And although we are unworthy, through our manifold sins, to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, throughout all ages, world without end.
Amen.
Let us pray. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed.
throughout all ages, world without end.
Thank you.
Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge of love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and with you all.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
The beginning of the Holy Gospel according to John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the word was made flesh, and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace